today's video, I'm going to be reading from a book. So if you enjoy that kind of video, it's going to be a little bit longer. So you can either pay attention, hopefully, or fall asleep. There's paper towel over the back of this because there is like location information on the back of this book that I don't want to give away. This book is called This Arab is Queer, and it's an anthology of queer Arabs. I apologize if I pronounce anything wrong. I'm reading from one of the stories in here, and I haven't read it before, so therefore I can't look up what words are in it. But I will try my best to pronounce everything correctly. This is called Pilgrimage to Love by Ahmed Umar. My name is Ahmed. I'm an artist who voices their thoughts through tactile and object-based artworks, a visual autobiographer and narrator of my own story. I use art as a fluent means of expression and a tool for creating a bridge of sensory communication between my own experiences and those of the audience. Art is my shield in resisting injustice, transforming my life and remedying my trauma. I grew up in a society where personal behaviors and individual freedoms were narrowed down to a couple of accepted ways of being forcibly allocated according to physical appearance. Puffing off a side stream where you are all yourself often motivated a social outcry and a demand to be brought back under the control of the ruling majority. The options left were either to resist, which is a limiting and costly process, or to submit and return to the mainstream and therefore completely lose the individual sense of self. Making art provided me with the symbols I used to decode my thoughts. It helped me create a universe where I am the ultimate leader of my being and destiny, an imaginary universe where my voice is neither censored nor restricted. I was born into a conservative Sudanese family who chose to live in the Arabian Peninsula, or Allah's house, rather than Sudan itself. I am the youngest child of five siblings, the last grape of the grapevine, as my family used to say. I spent the earliest years of my childhood at the heart of Mecca and the working class and crowded neighborhoods of Al-Mabda. We lived on a street named after the renowned pre-Islamic female poet, Al-Kanza. It was packed with randomly constructed buildings. Some were painted in white, others in desert beige. The majority were decorated with religious prayers, such as Allahu Akbar, God is the greatest, and Mashallah, which is a protective prayer against evil eyes. The prayer's presentation varied from building to another. Some were written with bricks that stuck out on the facade walls, but the majority were painted above the entry gates. But all of the houses had one common feature: small windows to keep the heat away and to provide women privacy and protection from the sight of male neighbors. People from across Saudi Arabia and even the world came together to meet at Al-Kanza Street. Parts of the street were named after the tribe or the immigrant group that settled there first. There were Saudi tribes like the Quraysh, Harb, Mukari, or the Javanese, who descended from the Indonesian island of Java. The Shanaget of Mauritania, and many others. Sudanese families like my own lived on the street as well, but were scattered about it. My father, Siddiq, was known among the neighbors for his peaceful disposition, his traditional Sudanese jalabia, and his red Toyota Crusetta 1979 that he kept until his passing in 2009. He was also known for playing host to an endless number of Sudanese guests. He welcomed everyone into our home, relatives, friends, friends of friends, friends of friends of friends, and others. Visiting our home was a religious ritual of sorts that all my father's acquaintances undertook when visiting Mecca. It was almost as holy as visiting the Kaaba and the Holy Mosque. My mother, Zainab, is my heroine, a powerful, wise, and generous woman. She is also elegant, tall, and blessed, with a gracious and poetically round face. She often wore her voluminous hair in a Sudanese traditional style called masayir. Mama's face reminded me of a line from a song by renowned Sudanese singer our face between the musty air resembles the full moon. Mama was also fearless. She has spoken up against much injustice caused by the patriarchy and social norms. Mama and I protected each other. I teamed up with her in many ways. Sometimes I helped her with chores, such as the time we killed a rat that was terrorizing our neighbors. I was at her side wherever she went. This close relationship with my mother made family members and outsiders call me Wadomo, Mama's boy. This title has negative connotations. It is given to boys whose attachment to their mothers exceeds the socially accepted boundaries of their age. Nonetheless, my childhood was rich with memories of Akansa. I was often found climbing the Jabals mountains on either side of the street, playing barefoot football, which I was never good at anyways, and jumping between 2 5-story buildings as if I were Spider-Man. I was an introvert rebel. I was quiet but could easily turn into a resilient fighter whenever my sense of self was threatened. On my street, respect was earned and had to be maintained regularly. I chose to fight back. From a young age, I was off the social beat, a light-skinned Sudani with an afro and an attitude unlike that of my peers. I was also feminine and did not fit into a socially accepted template. I enjoyed being a kid who explored both their femininity and their masculinity. I played dress up with both my father's clothes and my mother's. My sisters also dressed me up a few times. They called me Hana, a female name that means a high state of joy. It was also an accurate description of my feeling then and now. I've been falling in love with other boys for as long as I can remember, even while I was living in Mecca. I didn't know anything else. I had a crush on Hussein, Mohammed, even my teacher, Amin. I was in 5th grade when those feelings were described to me for the first time. The teacher of the Fiqh, an in-depth religious studies subject at school, explained to the class that there were 2 kinds of human beings, normal and then gays and lesbians. I remember the teacher taking up 1/3 of the blackboard when he wrote the word gays. When a man loves a man and they practice the love, wait, sex between them, astaghfirullah, may Allah protect us from the devil, he said, it is haram and utterly disgusting. Allah punished the gays in the past by turning Sodom and Gomorrah upside down. The teacher proceeded to gesticulate with exaggerated flamboyance to demonstrate how gay people talk. He said gays and lesbians were a plague to society and that they should be removed. He listed 5 ways of getting rid of homosexuals. The mild of this was public beheading. He added that the bodies of gays should not be buried in a Muslim graveyard, but thrown into the desert to rot. That particular class and this particular teacher put me off exploring the idea of homosexuality for many years to come, planting a shame and self-loathing within me. When I finished elementary school, puberty hit me. I could no longer disguise my voice shift by saying that I had a cold. As I had said for the past 6 months, my mustache and monobrow started to mark my face. I rejected puberty because of the social expectations that awaited me. I knew masculinity would be a heavy burden I couldn't carry. I didn't want to be called a man and be responsible for my actions before Allah. Then I began intermediate school, where I met Adele. He was one of the most beautiful boys on campus, popular, extrovert, and with a sense of strong sense of self. He stood up against bullies and demanded himself against older boys who tried to sexually harass him. He had light, hazel-colored eyes and a massive crown of soft hair. I can still feel the smooth texture of his hair, hands, and cheeks. I was known for being the only Sudanese boy in the whole school. Not only that, but a Sudanese who was not very dark-skinned, short-tempered, nor masculine. I was often asked questions like, how can you be Sudanese when you're not choker black? On many occasions, I had my headwear taken off by other boys so that they could mess up my exposed afro. I was also called a girl by both students and teachers. While deep within me, I never took it as an insult. I still had to act as I did to avoid raising suspicions. I subscribed to a school radio for the chance to spend time with Adele. We had become friends. We had become friends and hung out during breaks. We stayed back as late as we could. depression came too. I waited for Allah's revenge, but the earth split and swallowed me like the people of Lot and Sodom and Gomorrah. Or would I be punished with eternal unhappiness? Maybe I was already infected with AIDS, the guaranteed fate of any man who lusts over men, as the Thieg scholars claimed. It was hard to see or talk or tell in the days following the kiss, but my body couldn't resist his presence. I got goosebumps when he was near. A few days later, he asked me to meet him in our corridor after break was over. This time, I took strawberry-flavored chewing gum that pigmented my lips red. When I arrived, he was standing there without a smile. I smiled back. I kissed him. We ran in silence again, each to our respective classes. I fell in love. I also fell into a trap with my conscience. I felt I had no honor. All the doubts and accusations about my sexuality would be true if I accepted this love. I could not be angry when someone called me anymore. I was handing my fate to the devil. Adele and I kissed a few more times after that, but eventually we chose brotherhood over love. Many years later, he married a woman and had children with her, but remained best friends until the day he laughed about my contribution to a campaign about child molestation in the Arab world. We haven't spoken since. I continued my studies in Sudan, where I was sent because higher education was cheaper than in Saudi Arabia. Despite growing up and spending most of my life in Saudi, I had no automatic right to study there. I also felt it was safe in Sudan to start a new life with the correct attitude, and this worked out well. I was popular in college, sharp, and with a wide vocal social network, in some ways like my father. I was academically successful and achieved highest grades in all my subjects, in many ways what my mother wished me to be. But I differed from my siblings and school friends who all had someone they loved, and then Isra came into my life. Isra embodied all expectations of beauty sought after by traditional Sudanese families. She had wondrous large eyes, russet skin, long and soft hair. She had poise and was religiously committed to a degree that she didn't shake hands with men. We connected on many levels. We became best friends, or according to colored rumor, a couple. But custom had it that we could not officially call it that until I said I love you. Those three words had to be dragged out of my mouth. One day, Isra came to me and said, "Ahmed, this guy, Ahmed, who has been hanging around with us, is asking to marry me, and I don't know what to answer. I need a confirmation from you. Are we a couple, or shall I accept him as a husband?" I said quickly, "Yes, we definitely are." "Then you must do something," Isra said. "What?" "Say I love you." "I love you." Louder. I didn't hear it. "Do you mean it, or what?" "No, no, I mean it. I love you, I love you, I love you." "Stop," she giggled. "Stop, you're crazy. Everyone can hear us." Finally, I was in a relationship that was halal. I could even brag about it among my friends and family. Every day on my way to class, I whistled through the window of her class to say hello and wish her a good day. We were apparently so in love that she once broke her rule, held my hand, and wrote with a marker, "I heart you." Isra and I spoke about establishing a home together. We planned on having 10 kids, and I love children, despite the fact that I had never thought of her in a sexual way. Still, I promised to protect her and to cut off any arm that tried to touch her. A few months into my love story with Isra, the school organized a field trip study to the Blue Nile State in southern Sudan. The trip's objective was to study nature and meet the tribes of Ambara, Aro, and Nkasana, and learn about their culture and art. We were segregated according to our sex. Boys and girls slept in different houses. This region of Kisan was incredibly beautiful. The village where we stayed lay under a lush forest of wild mango and papaya trees. The area had been affected by the Civil War. The forest floor was filled with mines, so we were ordered to walk in groups or with locals and not stray far from the house. On the first evening of our trip, the boys gathered for tea and played cards on the floor of the house. Suddenly, a snake crept onto the middle of the carpet, freaking everybody out, until one of the boys, Osman, killed it. And this was on the same floor we were to sleep on. I refused to sleep on the ground that night. A few other boys and I agreed to sleep on the roof of the bus instead. One of these boys was Ashraf, an attractive boy with beautifully ambiguous features, like most people who have mixed Sudanese and Arab heritage. Sorry for the noise. We were good friends, and our girlfriends were best friends, but secretly I had a soft spot for him. I was the only boy who traveled with full sleeping gear. I was made fun of it for in the beginning and called Burad. But soon enough, Ashraf's head appeared on one side of my mattress, Nazar's on the Hassan and Mohammed also shared my sleeping kit. After a couple of nights on the bus, Ashraf ended up lying on the mattress with me. He was uncomfortable sleeping on just a thin sheet laid directly on the metal roof. Another couple of nights passed, and we ended up sleeping in the same direction instead of lying with our heads on opposite sides of the mattress as we had initially done. Then one night, I woke up with a warmth of Ashraf's breath on my lips. His breath often had a distinct taste of tobacco. It was so cold. Ashraf was looking at me, the moon reflecting in his eyes. I looked back at him. I froze. I don't know for how long, but long enough for my body to grow up. He put his hand around my waist and kissed me. Soon after, we turned our backs to each other, but I couldn't sleep for the rest of the night. I met Ashraf the next morning as he was sipping his tea with a cigarette. He looked very sad. I asked, "Are you okay?" "Ahmed, are we really gay now?" he said. "We cannot do this. We are brothers. We should help each other from getting deep into this dangerous path." "I think we are gay," I replied. "And yeah, I agree. We should save ourselves from the sin." But despite this conversation, we continued kissing each other goodnight for the rest of the trip. We remained regularly intimate for another year and a half. Then I left for Norway. That's the end of that. What was that title? I think I'll read the second one as well. So this is "In August, a September, and my mother" by Amina. "Somewhere over Ike's violin, under Ahmed's voice, the woman I love laughs, and everything inside me reaches up to hear it better. She holds me by the waist, hands light and then enveloping. Our hips magnetize and we dance. I tilt my head onto her shoulder and I laugh too, loudly and at nothing. In joy or disbelief, I'm not sure. It is the 22nd of December, September 2017, and in the concert area of the Mega Mall, 35,000 people gather for Mashrooz Leila's biggest show ever in Cairo. Biggest ever show in Cairo. The air view, Cairo. The air feels a little delirious, maybe from the heat or the crowd or the cheap tequila-flavored beer our friends smuggled in for us. Barely 20 meters in front of us, the three of those 35,000 people raise rainbow flags like wings. They are magnificent, and the crowd goes wild. They catch a bit of wind, and the multicolored things, which ugly men will later swear on TV were smuggled across borders to ruin our great nation, are nothing but bright. Their colors glow under the spotlights as they soar above brave shoulders, beacons in the night. I see a man morphed by my memory into the worst of faceless, middle-aged Egyptian men pick a fight with the flag bearer. The latter spins, wielding a rainbow in one hand like a threat and a flaming sword. He barks so fiercely that the man who accosted him sulks off with his tail between his legs, looking over his shoulder like he's planning revenge. We cheer for the hero flag bearer more than we do for our favorite songs. This is all happening in the festival grounds of a mega mall. 500 meters away from us, upper middle-class Egyptian families are treating themselves to a Friday night dinner at Ball or Chili's. Shared an app table with a view of the dancing fountain, while a maid sings about us and for us. We scream, the ground quakes under our feet, and one guy walks around in a bunny suit and makes people laugh, and two young men who don't know any different kiss, and she smiles against my cheek, and it feels like pride. 35,000 people, bigger than protests, and it feels like pride. Not across oceans and borders among strangers, drunk at a parade in a town that does not despise or know us, but here, in Cairo. We will repeat it often in the months that follow, to friends who were not there, to skeptics, to ourselves. In that moment, it felt like pride. A month before the concert, it is August. We are meters away from my grandfather's beach house. My grandfather, who would have loved you if he could. My mother, who absolutely loved you, if only the ever-polite best friend, is waiting up for us to come back from what she thinks is a night out. It is 2 a.m. and we are sitting on a white beach at the edge of the water. Our lips taste like salt, and save for a few teenage stragglers kicking up sand as they walk past, we are alone. The wind picks up, and our bodies grow impatient to get home. Where we are young and gasping, and every muffled note is urgent. Before we leave, you say you want to see a shooting star. With my face pressed to your cheek, my hands resting at the home of your waist, I whisper harder into skin. I kiss you there, three slow kisses into the smiling apple of your cheek. For a breath, everything pauses before a piercing meteorite splits the sky in two. Years after, long after you are long gone, I will still be able to hear the gasp that flies out of your mouth, your body rising like you're about to meet the star where it lands. I think that is when you started calling me magic. I think that is when I started to believe in God. Like Gabriel coming down to Gahara, like a heavenly voice using an ancient, anxious prophet. Like the Red Sea split to salvation, God pierced the sky for me. In another life, one where I do not lie about love, I rush home to tell my mother. I crouch at the edge of her prayer rug and prattle off like I do about every happiness in the world, not to break her heart. She looks up from where she kneels, a gentle lecture about God and signs and thankfulness floating from her lips. She shakes her head and ushers me away as she does one more raka, keeps her forehead to the floor a little longer, asks God to keep me happy, asks God to keep me safe. Father, right of the crowd, probably 10,000 bodies away, another constellation of flags shimmers, each a lighthouse to us and each other. I will never know which was Sarah's. I do not know if the person in front of me, who climbs on someone's shoulders and spreads the flag behind them like wings, so close we can almost jump to board, is Sarah. I do not know if I watch as the photo of her apotheosis is taken, but I know that, right then, it is joyful and fortifying and makes us scream as we reach for each other and abandon. Desire spills out of us and we do not hurry as we are trained to pick it up and hide it away from idiot eyes. The night is all glory and we are out. The night is ours. Two boys in mesh, which they will later cover up with hoodies, kiss, and a girl with a septum piercing that she will later turn inwards, falls in love with the first girl she flirts with, and a couple who I will later see on Instagram, marrying other people, borrow a flag for a kiss. That night, we fall asleep in the boundless love of Sarah Skyro. But the following day, the air sours, ugly men call us vile on national TV, and my mother asks me if that wasn't the concert I was at last night. I clutch my mug, the roll of my eyes, a well-rehearsed life boy that I hope will buy me enough time before I have to respond. A strip of fabric hails Armageddon, they say, a Western import to come to destroy Egypt. A moral decay infests the rich kinds of private university. Kids' private universities. I sip my tea and force a laugh in the corner of my eye pours into my mother. 30,000 homosexuals, one of the man screams. An orgy, a satanic ritual, a group renting in disguise. I call it bullshit, and maybe my mother doesn't hear the terror that's moved into my voice. They read from a script. The police must launch an investigation. Someone must be held accountable. Someone must be punished. The onslaught is endless. Talk show hosts consider us with all the compassion of homeowners, deciding what to do with a dog they're not sure is rabid. They debate putting us down or driving us to another neighborhood where we must be someone else's problem. My mother gets bored and switches the channel, and I retreat. Those of us who do not have reason to fear a sudden pounding on the door lie awake in the same darkness of that night, pinned in our beds by the cruel glare of our mobile phones, as childhood friends and loved ones who will be neither friends nor loved when the sun comes up to bait our humanity. They will do this again in 3 years' time when Sarah is gone, but I do not know that yet. I have never thought myself a sin. My queerness has never curled into self-loathing, save for a few days when a woman first lowered my heart, when something unnamed and afraid tried to rear its head. I have always held my queerness gently in my ribs, a secret I am not ashamed of. I have never tried to rip it out, claws sharpened by a childhood religion lessons and the manly kind woman who raised me. I have never believed that the God who sends me up a shooting star is the same one that idiots yell about on TV for spit flying out of their mouths. There's quakes and anger at my love. Mine smiles, honored by a soul loving the very best of his image. She spoke to me once, the woman who slowed my heart, of Vita and Virginia's letters, and how she is reduced to a thing that once Virginia. That night on the beach, she is glowing and total and nothing less than divine, and I am too reduced to a thing that once Thorea. It is a man with a child's laugh who will tell me later that the cluster of stars that she picks out like flowers at 2 a.m. Five delicate pinpricks, so small, so deliberate, as they huddle for warmth, is called Thorea. He will tell me a or the Seven Sisters soars infinite through the cosmos with her Dorbin. The shepherd loves her in the brightest star in the sky. And the brightest star in Taurus, never far behind. God has never denied me my Therea. Every night when I am lucky enough to lie underneath a pinprick sky, God reaches for me, blinks to me from behind a cluster, and reminds me that we are nothing but love. The idiots do not know that. When Zara dies, far away in a land that barely knew her, far from the Cairo that she danced into being and that killed her in return, it begins again. After we are killed, is it haram to wish us wistful peace? Are we worth praying for? What horrors does Zara advance? Let incarnate unleash. What is it? What is to be done with us, they ask. We ask, what becomes of us, our lives, and our memories, if we are remembered at all? Among ourselves and alone, we grieve for someone who we will never know. We form half images, listening for echoes of who she was in secondhand memories. Zara with wings, Zara lying in a field, Zara in a bursting, squinting smile, Zara sending a dear friend a birthday video so tender it rips our hearts out, Zara holding love in hand, singing along to Kathom. Let me dream, let me dream. We who never met her try to now, mining for clues to who she was in videos and old posts and talk of hope and solidarity while they condemn us to hell, to a world so torturous and forever that neither we nor they nor any human since the first can truly comprehend. Our community knows a few things as well as we know. 24-hour-long panic attacks, when the air shifts and the state starts hunting and the mentally the apps and we brace ourselves. We are learning, slowly, how to hold each other through them. We are learning that it is a trick of the mind and the state that makes our fear and our love collapse into one, flattening us as if we are all the same. We are not all the same. Are you cis? Are you rich? Are you Muslim? Are you a man? Are you English-speaking? Have you been seen dating the opposite sex? Do you live in Cairo? Do you have a foreign passport? Is your father powerful? Is your mother loving? We don't often think about that last one as the privilege it is. Is my mother loving? Yes. She loves every part of me that she knows. My mother, who, as we sit down to iftar at the sunset the day after Zara's passing, says she can't stop thinking about what happened to that poor girl in Canada. I mine her face, but there's nothing more than sympathy for a far-off stranger. After I spend the night twitching and gasping awake like a soldier who nodded off at his post, my mother does not know why my eyes are bloodshot in the morning. Sorry. That was my stomach. I cry and like a child tell her I had a nightmare. I lie to my mother about so many of my sadnesses that she thinks I am prone to depression. She thinks there are just these spells that come once in a while when there is nothing for her to do but make sure there are snacks in the house and the cake I like, and she is around more often than not. My mother revels in my happiness because she thinks it fragile. My mother is never more alive than the day of my brother's wedding. He makes a beautiful groom. He is warm and fun and loving. He dances with his bride, his smile all bewilderment, his laugh booming through the crowd. He twirls her and holds her, and the people who love and raise them sway all around them, dancing with joy. My brother and I look alike. In the middle of the crowd, I recognize the look he gives his bride, because I have looked at a woman the same way, enchanted and alive. I have known that love, joyous and overflowing. I have felt it, and might, if I am luckier than I sometimes want to be, feel it again. But my mother will never be happy for me like she is tonight for my brother. She will not invite her friends to see as she beams at her life coming full circle, or run to the DJ requesting songs I can twirl her to on the dance floor. My mother, to whom I have lied about so many of my sadnesses, will not find it in her to dance with me on that day, and I will not ask her to. So I dance with her now instead. Sorry. My brother tips his bride, who throws her head back in laughter. My mother sways a little offbeat, veil nearly slipping, singing in gorgeous abandon. And right then, I love them a little extra. I dance a little bigger. I swallow my heart and throw my hand around my brother's waist, and he looks down at me, and we meet the same smile. I look across at my mother, and I sing louder, eyes squinting in the lights, and the tear I call back. I pretend for an instant that it is my wedding too. I take my mother's hand, twirl her. By the time she faces me again, I am in a white dress. Next to me is the most beautiful. vision in a white dress or a suit that makes me weak. I smile at her, all bewildered, and at my mother, who is here, dancing and yelling at me to play her favorite songs. She is stunning in a dress she promised she would lose weight for every night as she bit into a mango but never did. I dance with her, and for an instant, the fantasy is real. My brother tightens his arm around me, and the crowd is almost flying. In an instant, I take all that joyful noise and all that screaming love, and I store it somewhere safe in the gentlest parts of me, where I keep my whispered dreams and my grandfather. If I am lucky, if I am astoundingly wonderful lucky, one day I will have a wedding of my own. It will be flooded with light. Those we love will love us. Everyone will get drunk and laugh at nothing. I will hold my love, and it will feel like bride, and it will feel like home. I will hold my love, and it will feel like... Sorry, I already read that. Then I will take this memory of my mother out of its hiding place, and I will dance with her. She will look at me with tears in her eyes, none of them repentant, and hug me, and I will be loved and loving. And when we are done, my mother will kneel on her bright rug as she does, and she will thank God for my joy and that she got to see it. She will pray for my love and whisper safeguards from envy, as she does for all our happiness. God will blink at me from the sky, never refusing my mother's wishes, and we will all be all right, I hope. Here's a part at the end. It says, Majru Leila is a rock band from Lebanon. They are known for songs that challenge and satirize the political elite, who are also addressing cultural stigmas and social issues. This piece references a Majru Leila concert in Cairo in September 2017, during which a few fans unfurled rainbow flags. One of those fans was Sarah Lakazi, who was arrested by Egyptian security forces soon after. Majru Leila were subsequently banned from performing in Egypt after her ordeal. Sarah sought asylum in Canada in June 2020. Far from home, she tragically took her own life. Okay, I'm about halfway through this book, and that was the most difficult story that I've read. Yeah. This is a very long video. It's probably gonna take forever to upload, but I'm reading this book as part of Read Palestine Week. I posted a video yesterday about Palestine. Information on that.